the last class, took us to the heights of evolution on this earth, namely the initiation of ascension, which in itself is a major step in our journey to freedom, for that step in itself frees us from what the Lord Buddha described as the wheel of rebirth and reincarnation upon earth. And from there, we are free to go to interplanetary existence and live upon higher planetary cultures in our system. So today we're taking an even higher step through evolution to Saturnian existence, the highest state of planetary existence in our system. And later we'll also deal with the ninth blessing, the supreme lords of karma, a very elevated aspect of creation who, we're told by the Master Jesus, is more holy even than the mighty sun, and who play a critical role in the functioning of our universe, without which creation would not be able to exist as we know it. Now, to go back for a moment to Saturn, although Mars Sector 6 gives us a very wondrous glimpse and insight into the glories of Saturnian existence and our great destiny which is to come, the fact is that we are so far removed at this point in our evolution from the heights of Saturn that it may seem to us to be utterly remote. But the point is that however far above us the beings of Saturn are, they are nevertheless very intimately interwoven and connected with our life on Earth. Our master often used to say that truth is dual-poled. It has a positive aspect and a negative aspect. And of course, this is in the magnetic sense, not in the right and wrong sense. So on the one hand, the beings of Saturn are far above us, but on the other, they touch every life stream in the system. They touch every aspect of us on Earth as part of the great oneness and interconnectedness of all life. So now, as this is part of a service as well as a class, let's prepare ourselves. Let's just close our eyes and just focus our minds, just clear our minds of the thoughts of the outside world. Open ourselves to the wisdom of the cosmos. Let us place our hands downwards on the knees, the fingers outstretched. Have our spine straight. Let our breath become deeper and slower. Quieting the mind, relaxing the body. Now with our mind's eye, let us look downwards, down deep into the earth beneath our feet, where dwells a mighty life form, the logos of the Mother Earth herself. And let us request in humility for the wondrous violet fire of cleansing and transmutation. And let us visualize this great violet flame rising up from the earth, flowing right through our body, filling every aspect of our body, flowing through the aura and cleansing all the dross within it. And see this great violet fire, feeling its velvet touch as it flows through us upwards into the ether above. And now let us look upwards. And let us visualize coming down through the ethers a brilliant scintillating white light, a very flame of God. And bring this white light down into the head and brain. See it permeating every cell of the brain. Take it down through the neck and shoulders and out into the heart center, just in front of the body at the base of the breastbone. Now, if you've been given the mantra that we use, let us please join together the holy mantra, Om Mani Padme Hum. Om Mani Padme Hum, 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 Om. In the eighth freedom, Saturnian existence, Mars Sector 6 tells us that when an intelligence has gained experience in lives on other planets in the system, and they're ready to take the next step up in evolution, they are then initiated and they enter through the logos of the planet Saturn into what is called the secondary life cycle on Saturn itself. At this point, the intelligence is neither a male or a female, but both, in the highest possible sense, actually what our master calls a threefold being, both male and female, and a perfect balance between these two. So Saturn has two levels of existence, the secondary life cycle, and above that, what is called the primary life cycle, and there's just almost a universe of difference between these two levels. Mars Sector 6 gives us a very graphic illustration of the evolution of consciousness, which I will read. The wheel turned twice, and consciousness was born. The wheel turned four times, and consciousness was evolved up to interplanetary level. The wheel turned 1,980 times, and consciousness was evolved up to secondary Saturnian level. The wheel turned 9,458 times, and consciousness was evolved up to primary Saturnian level. So we can see what a vast difference there is, certainly from where we are and up to primary Saturnian level. So when a being enters the primary life cycle of Saturn, it amalgamates with another being and becomes a sixfold being. It then leaves the system and goes into meditation for 125,000 years. And after that, it goes into the primary hall of initiation upon the sun. And after that, it is ready to become a part of the Supreme Interplanetary Council. Let's now listen to an extract of Mars Sector 6 giving a description of such a being, again expressing this great paradox of truth. For example, such a one is silent, and yet all sound, and so on. Let us close our eyes and listen to the great Lord Mars Sector 6.
As such a one has no individuality, as such a form, it is all individual, has no sex, as such a form, it is a twice female, a twice male, and a twice neither. As such a one has a still a body which moves not. As such a one is capable of a division of consciousness which allows it to inhabit up to 1,860 positions in the time-space continuum at one and the same instant. In fact, some of the perfects are able to double this feat. As such a one is not limited because of limitation. As such a one has great freedom because it has rejected all freedom. As such a one has access to all mind because it has consciously and super consciously on the intuitive levels rejected all mind. As such a one is an active blood vessel in the arm of the Absolute. As such a one is a flame of everlasting inspiration. Such a one is all silent, and yet all sound, is stillness, and yet all movement, is a single entity made up of the amalgamation of two, and yet is all entities. Such a one as this is beyond description. It is the flame . It is the guiding light which shows us all the way through our darkness. It is an enactment of supreme sacrifice, everlasting service. It is a great and mighty existent intelligence on its way to a complete amalgamation with a divinity itself.
Now standing above even the great masters of this primary level of existence on Saturn are what we know as the 12 perfects of Saturn. And Mars Sector 6 tells us that they couldn't find a more descriptive term in English. Than to refer to these 12 majestic beings as the 12 perfects. We're going to play another extract now from a different lesson that was given by Mars Sector 6, but illustrate how gloriously these wondrous beings do affect life throughout the system. Let us listen again to Mars Sector 6.
The 12 perfects in the temple of the gods remain immobile, wrapped in their wonderful silence for eons, and yet from their mighty souls pour forth the rays of inspiration out unto every life stream in the solar system, so that it may be impregnated with these mighty rays, so that it may be vibrated with these mighty rays, Down, down they come. Not even the worst and most basic aspects of man can stay their holy flow. Even now, as you listen to me, they impregnate you. They vibrate through you. They are a great stream of coursing life. They are life. The perfects. Are great beings who have had a divine initiation upon the Holy Sun itself, and they have had a further cosmic initiation which took place in the most secret, secret places outside of this solar system. Then they returned to Saturn so that they might help the more basic life streams to express their divinity. Listen, Terra. Listen, Terra. Listen, Terra. That is sacrifice. And yet, the perfects would not grasp your praise. They desire not your love. The perfects, all the most ancient ones, desire only that all more basic life streams express in full the divine spark of that thing that you would call God, which is within.
The perfects of Saturn, together with other of the great beings, form a what we might call a governing body or tribunal of this solar system, which seeks to guide and teach and help all life streams on every level of existence throughout the system. This used to be called, when we first heard of it, Interplanetary Parliament. It's not like our governing bodies. It exists purely to raise all life, to realize its divinity, as we have just heard. And these great ones in the advisory body or governing body are responsible to the masters of the sun for the evolution of all life in the system, whether it be a tree in Yorkshire, in England, or someone living upon Mars, Venus, Pluto. These great masters help guide and inspire in the right way such a life stream so that it may be taken upon its long journey back to God. Before I hand over to Reverend Paul, I would like to just add that another way in which we have direct connection with Saturn is that when we pass on from this realm, we do travel to Saturn, and there, before one of the great beings, we are given what we are told is the greatest wisdom, the ability to judge ourselves. And our greater consciousness is able to see how we succeeded and failed in our life, and so see how or what lessons and experiences are going to be needed to help us in our evolution in our next incarnation. And so I now pass this over to Reverend Paul.
Well, thank you very much, Right Reverend Leslie. I must say, just listening to those two extracts we just heard makes it very difficult to really be able to say too much from a terrestrial point of view about these beings. One is completely and totally humbled, and it is difficult for us to really get our minds around not just the greatness of these ones, but the purity and the holiness of these great beings, and the realization that they do truly exist. There's one of the early lines in our teachings, I think actually it was made by Mars Sector 6, but he says, makes the statement, if you breathe, Aetherius lives. It's a wonderful way of saying how real the Master Aetherius is. We are breathing, and we are breathing because of beings such as the Master Aetherius. And I think that absolutely certainly can also be said of the great beings upon Saturn who have watched over us for millions and millions of years. In fact, one needs to go back even beyond our incarnation upon this earth over 18 million years ago. My part here is to explain how, one way at least, these masters from these perfects, these lords of Saturn, are helping humanity, especially at this time. And in order to do that, one really has to have their perspective rather than our perspective. From their perspective, they can see the complete history of mankind, how we fell from a previous planet where we inhabited, known as Maldek, how we fell through two civilizations here upon this earth, Lemuria and Atlantis, and how we have come to our present state of evolution. And to that extent, I refer you all, if you have never read and studied the Nine Freedoms, please do so, not just for these great freedoms, but also for the introduction by Dr. George King, where he explains about our evolutionary past, our previous civilization on Maldek, which we destroyed, and through Lemuria and Atlantis, again, both of which we destroyed. And without going too much detail because of lack of time, but they, in all of this, knew that we had discovered the way to destroy ourselves again in the middle of the last century through the use of the atom bomb, later the development, at least, of the hydrogen bomb. And their care was not only about us, but all life in this solar system, including the planet herself, the Mother Earth. And this is something that was spoken about by the Cosmic Masters through Dr. George King, both prior to this great happening, what we call the initiation of Earth. And everything really is a consequence of that initiation, which she, as a planetary logos, received in July the 8th, 1964. And the great cosmic masters, particularly the great beings upon Saturn, could see the inevitable consequences that would arise out of that initiation. And so the first little extract I'd like to play was given by the master Aetherius in August the 22nd, 1964, just a few weeks after this initiation of Earth, when the planet, the Logos, was given a tremendous infusion of cosmic energy that she had awaited, that she had karmically deserved. And in this little short extract, you'll get a little understanding of some of the repercussions of that initiation. So if we could play that, please, now.
Let me repeat it in another way. Today, now, your spiritual actions will be more fruitful than ever they have been before in your total history. Today, now, karma will be balanced quicker than ever before in your total history. Whether that karma applies to you as an individual, as a member of a race, a country, or the whole mass of humanity, this will be so. Therefore, because this is so, it is only logical to conclude that never before was spiritual action as essential as it is now. Must also be remembered, dear friends, that as well as the conditions I have spoken of, now since the initiation of Terra has taken place, which it did, of course, in the month you call July, since that time, great changes are being brought about within the planet itself. These changes will manifest as a quickened vibration of all matter upon the planet. Everything, if you want to put it simply, will become a quicker. A change will be quicker than it was before. The weather will change in a more dramatic manner than it has ever done before. The seas will change. Gradually, the whole seasons will begin to change until they do not have the division that they have now. This latter change will be gradual.
Well, I think as we stand here, almost 60 years after that transmission was gone, was given, how prophetic that statement was. I think we can all relate to the quickening of just about everything in life and in our own lives. And of course, the Master Aetherius referred specifically to changes in our weather. And that, one of the big debates, topics of conversation, and certainly concerns today is what we call climate change. And the masters obviously foresaw that, and they could foresee at the same time the kind of havoc and devastation that would have, would wreak upon our world in all kinds of ways. And so to that extent, one of the great ways in which these great interplanetary beings, and specifically the lords of Saturn, are helping humanity at this time is through a mission we now call the Saturn Mission. It wasn't originally called that. It was originally called a mission for world peace and Devic stabilization, a stabilization of our natural conditions, the weather, etc. The mission was devised by these very great beings we've just been learning about, how they watch over us, help us, guide us. And the mission was first, the very first phase of this mission took place over a psychic center of the Mother Earth in Scotland, Loch Ness, in 1981. And its whole purpose, as I say, was to send energy to the higher Devic kingdom to help bring about a stabilization of our conditions, conditions that inevitably would be changing as a result of the initiation of Earth, but changes also exacerbated by the thinking and action and mindlessness of humanity, because our thoughts, our actions, our emotions, that energy also feeds the great Devic kingdom, as we studied when we studied the fifth blessing. And so it's quite remarkable how this mission, the Saturn mission, has been helping humanity. It was said, right, or one of the byproducts of the Saturn mission would be the saving of 90,000 people in each phase, either from death caused by one of these natural catastrophes or severe mutilation resulting from one of these natural catastrophes. And as bizarre and as extreme that may sound, dare I say, the statistics bear that out. And for the benefit of those who are watching online, to the detriment of those few who are able to be gathered here, but we have four slides that I'd like to show. The first of these shows the number of natural disasters from 1900 to 2012. Remember that transmission from the Master Aetherius in 1964, how we would see these become far more manifest upon our world. And where each of those bulges, I don't know how well you can see this slide online, but at the very top, that's the year 1900, you've got that thin line going down. And then it all begins to bulge out. And then the bulge begins right around 1960, 64, and only gets bigger and bigger as it moves towards 2012. Here there are five different drawings, one representing on the far left the climatological change or temperature change. Then you've got meteorological change, hurricanes, typhoons, etc. Then the third one is floods, the fourth one is geophysical, and the fifth one is biological. But you can just see this incredible, dramatic growth in the number of natural disasters, exactly as foreseen by the masters following the initiation of Earth as we go through this quickening period. And yet, the second chart that we have, if we could put that one up, again, this is actually from 1980, when the Saturn mission began, or 1981, actually, when it began the first phase. It's continued right up to the present time. We've now performed over 100 phases of this mission. And as the graph moves towards the right-hand side of 2019, you can just see, again, this exponential growth, just graphically shown in a slightly different way. And this also shows the massive increase in costs that these are having, in tens of billions of dollars. And yet at the same time, I now want to show the third slide, which is also from 1980 to the present time, 2019, which actually shows the number of deaths resulting from this dramatic increase in the number of disasters. And yet, you will see that it goes in entirely the other direction. How, despite this massive, tremendous increase in the number of natural disasters occurring all around our world, the death toll dramatically has greatly declined. And if we look at the fourth slide, you will see at the same time the growth in population, world population. In fact, since the Saturn mission began in 1981 to the present time, there's been an increase of almost three and a half billion people. So while there's been a tremendous increase in the number of people on Earth and a tremendous increase in the number of natural disasters, following the Saturn mission, with these great beings helping us, the death toll has greatly, greatly diminished. And to that extent, I'd like to just play now another short extract from an address given by Dr. King in December 1982. It was actually given on December the 26th, of course, so right over the Christmas period. And the title of the address is Divine Intervention, because he speaks about being Christmas, the birth of Christmas, being divine intervention. But he also speaks about the Saturn mission in a similar way. So let's just listen to this short extract from Dr. King.
In our lifetime, last year to be exact, marked another new era of divine intervention. And that was, of course, the Saturn mission, which again we were asked to cooperate. Not that Saturn needs idiots like us, but without we idiots, the mission could not have been performed, such as the karma of mankind. I'm not talking about the karma of the few, I'm talking about the karma as a whole. So therefore, we were able to help in the Saturn mission, which marks a new era, which marks a divine intervention, which is rather like another Christmas, if you want it, put it that way. And during the Saturn mission, we don't know exactly what was done, but we do know that one of the byproducts of this was saving 360,000 lives from premature death, I put that word in inverted commas, or severe mutilation from natural causes. It's not very difficult to prove, you know, that something did happen. In the United States of America this year, in 1982, as indeed I prophesied, they have been some of the worst storms in living memory. And yet the death toll has been very, very small. The damage has run into hundreds of millions of dollars. Thousands of people in your country today are homeless because of unusual weather conditions, but the death toll was very, very small. And I maintain this is a proof that something did happen, that the Lords chose to help man in this way, and they helped mankind through
the Aetherius Society and little bits of equipment which yours truly was able to design some years ago. And this, too, is a divine intervention. It's a help, as the coming of Krishna was a help to the world, as the coming of Buddha was a help to the world, as the coming of Jesus was a help to the world. This is another kind of help, but one extremely valuable.
As I said, that address was given in 1982, just 1 year after the Saturn mission was devised and the first phase had been performed. And there were just four phases performed at that time that Dr. King gave the address, hence the saving of 360,000 lives. And we, as I mentioned, we have now performed over 100 of these phases. We perform, the Aetherius Society performs three phases per year. Two here in the United States and one in the British Isles. So this now coming back to the service aspect of this morning's presentation, let us raise our hands in a prayer for the great beings, the great mighty lords of Saturn who watch over humanity and who have done so for millions and millions of years, guiding us through our evolution. O wondrous mighty Parabrahma, we lift our hearts and our minds and our souls to the great and mighty beings upon the planetary system we know as Saturn. O wondrous mighty God, humbly, humbly do we thank these ones for their holy, holy existence in our system, and for the great love and compassion, wisdom, and service through sacrifice which they render to us all. And O wondrous mighty God, we pray that we may be inspired in our own daily life to become more cognizant of the existence of these ones and of the great sacrifices which they make in this eternal journey from free will to thy divine freedom, O wondrous mighty God. In deference to these holy beings, do we intone thy sacred name once. It's my pleasure to hand you back to the Right Reverend Leslie Young, who will take us into the other aspect of this class, the Supreme Lords of Karma.
Turning now, as Paul says, to the Supreme Lords of Karma, other beings who are vital to the evolution of our lives, from free will to freedom. And in the ninth blessing, we learn how very high in creation these mighty beings are. Their function is to ensure that the laws of God, the laws which are God, work out perfectly. A master told us that these great lords of karma are greater than any conception of man or master. And that without the law of karma, manifestation as we know it would not have been possible in the beginning. Karma is an integral part of all life. Nothing is outside of it, from the highest to the least. And underneath the supreme lords of karma is a hierarchy, a karmic hierarchy, where great other great beings beneath these supreme lords work to operate the great law of karma throughout creation. Interestingly, some 30 years ago, Mars Sector 6 himself was appointed to the karmic board and became a lord of karma. And he could have, at that point, gone on to even higher existence than he currently enjoys, but he chose to sacrifice this in order to continue to help the less evolved beings that he was giving service to at that time. And throughout our teachings, we learn that higher beings sacrifice themselves on behalf of lower beings. The supreme lords of karma sacrifice themselves on behalf of all life. And this, our master says, is a part of the karmic law. The essential service performed by these great laws ensures the perfect working out of this great law of manifestation so that all aspects of creation can go through experience correctly on their journey back to God or their divine source. Well, it's a vast subject, and there's really no one better than our master to teach us about this blessing. So let's listen to an extract now from his lecture given in 1959 on the ninth blessing.
Blessed are the supreme lords of karma. These ones, great above words, more holy even than the mighty sun, stretch their influence throughout all the galaxy, so that the great laws of God, the great laws which are God, may be perfect in their balance. Whether we like it or not, all life is governed by one major law. And that law states that action and reaction is opposite and exactly equal. It doesn't matter whether we like this or not. It is so. Jesus, when he was on earth, spoke about this in a brilliant fashion. He said, "As you sow, so shall you reap." The metaphysician says, action and reaction is opposite and equal, and no man or adept or master can get away from this. No tree, no plant, no flower, no fish, no drop of water, no atom, no proton, no neutron, no force field, no energy even, can get away from this one great, basic, all-pervasive, all-governing law. For it's the law upon which all creation revolves. It is the axis of all creation. I'll repeat that. It is the axis of all creation. Whether we like it or not. There's an old English proverb that says, the mills of God grind slowly, but they grind exceedingly small. 'Tis the same thing. it was an idea put forward to express this great essential law. All those people who suffer with disease today do so because the law of karma, in its perfect balance, is working in its perfect balance. Karma stretches, as I've said, from pure energy to a life force, from manifested God or all the way through the every aspect of manifested God. It is the law upon which manifestation is built and made possible. Without the law of karma, manifestation as we know it would not have been possible in the beginning. It's the great law. Now, this great law is enforced, if that is the word, and it's not a good one, but we have to use it. It is enforced by beings. These beings are, as Jesus says, sacred beyond words. They stretch their influence not only through the galaxy, but from one end of manifestation, namely the energetic force around the proton, that's one end of manifestation, from one end of manifestation to the other end of manifestation, namely through the great galactic systems. They stretch their influence and power from the microcosm right the way through all manifestation to the macrocosm. And they ensure that the law of manifestation, note it, the law of manifestation, is, shall we say, works perfectly. In every respect, perfectly.
I now hand you back to Reverend Paul.
Thank you. Well, I'm given the task of talking a little bit more about the law of karma, but as Leslie says, it's far better to have Dr. King speak about this than myself. But I do remember one line, actually, believe it or not, I remember a few lines from the play Hamlet. It's probably my favorite play, but there's one line there which has always resonated, which says, "There's a divinity which shapes our ends, rough-hew them how we will." And I find that there's so much beauty, not just in that saying, but in what it conveys. There's a divinity which shapes our ends, rough-hew them how we will. In other words, no matter how we live our life, how bizarre and daft we can be, there is this overriding force that always is there to shape and push and bring us back to God. And Dr. King put it, perhaps not quite so poetically, but probably more brilliantly, certainly more specifically, when he said that karma is a pressure of you, the soul, and you, the mind, towards you, the spirit. And it is literally operating, as we heard, all of the time. There's another line in the ninth blessing to these supreme lords of karma. It says, "Men, you will never repay the debt you owe to these ones." And I think what that, we should never trouble, we should never have troubled them. They should, we should, had we not chosen this path of free will, we would not have had a need to disturb them. I use that word disturb, but trouble them. They would have been unruffled. And it is quite simply a debt that can literally never be repaid by man. Anyway, Dr. George King, let's listen to him now from one of several extracts he gave on this great law of karma, which of course dovetails entirely with the reincarnation, the law of the reciprocal law of reincarnation. But this is from a lecture which he gave in England, a short extract, in August 1973.
The karmic law can be stated very, very simply indeed. Jesus referred to the law of karma. He said, as you sow, so shall you reap. Not so may you reap, so shall you reap. His elder brother, the Lord Buddha, talking to a far more intellectual audience, put it like this. He said, action and reaction is opposite and equal. And if you know this one thing about the karmic law, from that you can conclude many aspects of truth. If you live within within these confines, you can learn much about your own karma, about the karma of the world, about the karma of mankind, and you can guarantee, if your action is correct, within these confines, what will happen to you, not what might, what will happen to you in a future life. If there's one thing in life that you have control over, it is your own karmic pattern. For 24 hours a day, you are forming this karmic pattern for yourself. Not 12 hours, not just while your eyes are open, but while you sleep as well, you are formulating this karmic pattern. It's a 24-hour-a-day formulation, and it continues right from before your conception into a physical body, onwards and upwards, we hope, or onwards and downwards, whichever the case may be.
Now I'd like to follow that with another extract from the original lecture given in March, I think it was March of 1959, with Keith Robertson reading an extract followed by an explanation by Dr. King. And this comes after the blessing was still given by the Master Jesus, but he'd ended, so endeth the ninth blessing. And then he went on to say these words. If we could listen to that now, please.
So endeth the ninth blessing. O sweet little God-respecting children, think on these things, but always. Do not let a moon set or a sun set before you think upon them, before you help constructively these mighty ones by the strict control of your own thoughts and actions. Bring these within the great law, and you will be praying a greater prayer than that of words.
Of course you will. Of course you will. Govern your own thoughts and actions to the best, absolutely to the best of your ability, which a lot of people certainly try to do, and many more don't try to do. Govern these, and you will be attracting to yourself what is commonly termed as positive karma, this will put you in a position to be of greater assistance to others, and you will gradually take your rightful place in the working out of the great cosmic plan for the enlightenment of all life, not only life upon this earth, but when we're talking about these beings, of all life. Because although man is but a maggot on a cheese in comparison with the Great One, he is a maggot upon a cheese. He is an essential part of the whole. Let us never forget this. We should feel small and humble in the face of such great knowledge and wisdom as this. We should have these feelings. But at the same time, let us not forget that we are not tools in a cog, but essential parts of a great whole. That if one of these parts does not perform its function correctly, it is enough to throw many, many more of the parts out of alignment or perfect work. That if all the parts got back to God as conscious God save one, it would mean that the whole lot would have to wait for that one to reach its goal. I cannot illustrate the vast importance of an individual in a better way than that. While we should be humble, we should always remember this, that we are essential parts of the great whole, that we can contribute towards the great whole by doing our part, by being of service to others, and by performing this and the other practices in this book, by just being quiet and sending out our love to the Lords of Karma. Visualize them in whatever way you like. The best way to visualize them is as a great blinding light out there somewhere. You needn't draw a picture of them in your mind. You cannot draw a picture of them in your mind. Just send out this power from your heart and love from your heart, and say a prayer, if you like. Dear God, I direct this towards the Lords of Karma, so that they can help all mankind. Be good enough. If your heart's pure, if your motives are not pure, no matter what you say or how you say it, you'll be invoking the law against yourself.
Well, in closing, or almost in closing, this part of the service, the book that Dr. King is referring to, of course, is the 12 Blessings. And right at the end of the ninth blessing, the Master Jesus gives this absolutely magnificent recommendation, if you can call it that, advice. It's for us to take, but, well, bless your brothers. Bless the Logos of your earth. Bless the mighty solar Logos. And then bless the Supreme Lords of Karma. And you will discover a satisfaction beyond all words. And I think for all of us who have followed that advice, have experienced exactly what the Master Jesus is referring to, a satisfaction beyond all words. And certainly beyond all money. It's a satisfaction that cannot be bought, only experienced. So with that, I'd like to invite our bishop back to offer a prayer for these Supreme Lords of Karma.
Let us please raise our hands. O divine and everlasting Spirit, Creator of all things, we humbly raise our hearts and minds in deepest reverence and appreciation for thy holy servants known to us as the Supreme Lords of Karma. O wondrous Parabrahma, though we dimly realize the true greatness of these holy beings, yet from the very depths of our souls do we honor their great work throughout all of creation, which enables all life to evolve through thy great law, through experience, back to thy everlasting heart. O wondrous Brahma, we pray that thy eternal blessings fall now upon these holy beings and fill them forever with the everlasting power of thy love. Let us join with the holy word once. Now, generally, we do finish our services with the holy practice of the presence, but we do have something different today. And this was, our master gave a lecture many years ago on life on the planets, and he went through the various planets that were covered by the transmission of that name. But when it came to the planet Saturn, instead of giving a lecture on it, he gave what he called a meditation. And we'd like to play this for you now because it's a very beautiful thing and it takes us through what we have looked at and studied today, which is Saturn and the great law of karma. So let us just close our eyes and just open our minds and hearts and follow the words of our master through this very beautiful conclusion to his talk on Saturn.
And we will talk about Saturn a little. I won't say very much, but I will say a little. And I'd like, if you wish, you to regard this as a kind of contemplation, should you so wish. If you do wish, I would ask you to close your eyes, be very nice and silent and quiet within, and try to follow the description I will give you. And try to gain power from it too, by the way, because this will help you. If it doesn't, well, then you be queer folk. Be at peace. Nice, gentle peace. Visualize the fact that you are leaving this earth. You feel quite free and you leave this earth and you go upwards through space. Now, you don't feel space as cold at all. You feel it extremely pleasant. And your destination, you know, is a great shining planet of Saturn. When you get nearer to Saturn, you become aware, far more aware, of things around you. You can see a great sea of colors blending and interblending one with the other. And this sea seems to wash around the shores of this great planet. You don't make any attempt at all to land on the rings of Saturn, which at the moment we will leave out of our visualization exercise, but you go through these and you begin to circle in towards the surface of the planet, and you begin to rotate in a spiral movement. Is very important. You gradually spin down and down and down until you notice before you a great opening, rather like the opening of a cave, which goes downwards. The great seas of colors seem to close over you. And you go down into deep purple silence. You continue this spiral movement, and it gets more purple than ever, more silent than ever, absolute quiet now, until you suddenly notice you're no longer traveling. When your eye becomes sensitized to your conditions, you see at the far end of a tunnel, or what looks like a tunnel, a white light, a brilliant white light. And you make your way gradually towards this white light. And as you get nearer to it, you can feel tremendous vibrations which seem to impinge upon you, and these vibrations seem to lift you, and you feel even freer than you did before, more charged than you did before, more mentally alert than you did before. And then you see from where the white light comes, and you stop still. You notice in front of you a crystalline substance rather in the shape of a very large upturned glass, some 20, 23 feet in height. Inside that huge upturned crystalline glass, there is something which looks like a huge incandescent egg, which is hovering about 3 or 4 feet from the floor, and some 15 or 18 feet in height. And you know that in that incandescent egg, radiating thousands of colors, is a great and vast intelligence. You stop still in awe, because you know that this intelligence knows you far more completely than you have ever known yourself at any time. But you also know that this intelligence will never condemn you, will help you, will guide you, but never condemn you. And you suddenly become aware of where you are. You're in one of the tribunal halls of Saturn. And as you stand or hover there, you know that you will return to that place again. you know that you will look again upon that great intelligence. And you know that when you do, this intelligence has been in this meditative state for 50 to 60,000 of your earth years, without moving one iota, and yet at the same time has split its consciousness into 2,000 different parts and is fully aware, even as you stand and look at it, of what each part is doing, even though they might be millions of miles apart, scattered right throughout the galaxy. You're standing in one of the tribunal halls on Saturn. You know that you will return. When you have passed this initiation called death, you will return to this place. The great intelligence in front of you is one of the perfects. You will come before this great being, but not to be condemned, not to be torn asunder, but to be built up. For this being will teach you the great secret. And the great secret is, he will teach you how to judge yourself. Now, my friends, this is not fiction, but fact. I know that this is so. I know that you will return to this place again. You will see that which I describe. It all depends upon your actions today and tomorrow as to how you will have to, by law, judge yourself. If your actions be the actions of a wise, sane, nice-thinking individual, you will be allowed to judge yourself as that. This great being will teach you beyond all doubt that your countless tomorrows are made for you today. It depends on how you act today, how you will act tomorrow, as to what judgment you must by law impose upon yourself when you pass through this initiation called death and return again to the tribunal hall of Saturn. Within this great being is a deeper compassion than anything you have ever heard of yet. You might do well to remember that. I like to say that I hope that God's blessings go with you all.
With our Master's blessings, let us join together in the Holy Word once. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. May thy will, O wondrous God, be done. This concludes our service and our class. With that beautiful visualization, there's really nothing more to say except thank you, God bless you, and may you be always guided in your journey through wonderful experience.